So I've done hundreds of experiments with jar feeding over the last couple of months. And beyond hole size, beyond pattern, and beyond the material that I make these out of, there's one factor that was much more important than any of that, and it's something that I had never thought of before and I've never heard of before. I've 3D printed a ton of these plastic discs, and the idea behind it is it goes into a mason jar just like a metal disc would, and then you're able to close it up. I've been testing with resins that are plastics and also with silicon, which is very flexible, also TPU, which is semi-flexible, also with metal, and also different types of materials that are not even on here yet. I'll show that to you here in a few minutes. I didn't have enough space to show you all the different experiments that I've been running. Different hole sizes as well. You can see here this is 0.5, 1.0, 1.21. I've done all of this variation in order to see what the ultimate jar feeder would be. These two jar feeders are what I call a control, meaning that they're known elements, they're products that are out on the market, and I wanted to see how they fare versus these. These have different patterns. So this one has like a star-shaped pattern. This has more of a sun-shaped pattern. I've also done similar patterns for mine, some of them being very small, dense patterns. This one's a 0.5 millimeter hole. I've built a pretty cool testing setup where I'm able to put in four different jar feeders at a time and have the bees come up from one hole in the middle and choose which one that they want to go to. I'm also able to randomize them by just switching around the jars to be able to make sure that I'm getting the results that I would expect. You can see in the bottom of the testing setup that I have trail cameras. And you may be wondering, why do the trail cameras have reading glasses on them? The reason is that these trail cams are built for being able to see deer 10 feet away in the dark. I want this to be able to see in the dark, which it does, but I want to be able to have the focal point much closer. And so I'm actually using reading glasses attached to these in order to bring that focal length in to about the size of a deep. If you're curious which reading glasses I used, it's between a 3.5 magnification and a 4.0 magnification. I'm still getting that right as far as getting the clarity. After countless tests over a couple of months with probably hundreds of different types of lids that I've 3D printed, different patterns, different hole sizes, what do you think I found? They all pretty much worked exactly the same. The bees congregate on the sides and they feed from the side holes. There was one and only one prototype out of all of those prototypes that the bees reacted differently to, and that is this twist-to-close prototype that I had created. The idea behind it is that if I go to the bee yard, I can then open it up when I put it on the inner cover, feed the bees, and then when I'm done, close it up and put it back in my car and not get any spillage. It's a convenience for the beekeeper. If you're getting value out of this content, please like and subscribe below. Believe it or not, this experiment almost broke my spirit. I was talking to my friend John, and John, if you're watching, thank you, man. I really appreciate all your advice. I told him that I'm actually depressed. I said I took a week off of experimentation. I was so frustrated. I put everything down and said, I'm not even sure if there's a right answer to this. John said to me, I've seen the video. The bees love it. They ignore the others. What's the problem? Why are you upset? I said, because they shouldn't like it. There's nothing unique about this. It has six holes in it. A lot of these prototypes have many more holes than that. It has 1.0 millimeter holes in it. Many of the prototypes that I developed are 1.0 millimeter. As a matter of fact, my control, which is the B bar, is exactly 1.0 millimeters. I even looked at the plastics that this was made out of, thinking, well, maybe they like the smell of it better, but it's made out of the same material as the other plastics. They shouldn't like this any more than they do any other type. It's a convenience for the beekeeper, but there's nothing really extraordinary about it. I was completely bamboozled and I thought, well, I've hit a dead end. I don't know. Why do they like it? If I don't know why they like it, how can I improve it? And then John told me, dude, this is a hard problem. This is something that other people probably haven't figured out yet. There's a reason it's hard. And just keep pushing because you're so close to the answer. And he was right. I doubled down reluctantly and I thought there is one mystery that I have not yet figured out with the jar feeding. Why is it that the bees are going around the sides and not going into the middle hole? I would have expected that the bees would uniformly feed off of the feeders the way that they do with this. And so as a bit of a jerk to the bees, I ended up creating a prototype where it only had one hole. And I created it in metal, I created it in plastic, and I created it in silicon with the idea that maybe I could figure out why they don't like to do that. It was kind of a stretch, to be honest. I thought, yeah, what else am I going to try? I can't think of anything else. I'm pretty much at a dead end. And what I found out was really interesting. I found out that the bees fall off of these materials very easily. It's almost like a human going out on ice. I've added some sound effects to this video just to make it interesting. But you can see that the bees are very hesitant to walk out on these materials. And when they do, they fall very easily off of them. I guess it's not a big stretch to say that the bee claw is actually designed to be able to hold on to things like wood, but probably not so much onto things like metal, especially in an inverted space where they're upside down. They're especially bad on silicon, but definitely the metal and the plastic were a surprise to me. I watched the old videos with a new perspective, and I started to realize that the rare bee that would actually go to the center hole, she would typically hold on with her claw to one of the other sides with a back leg, a front leg, and I started to realize that this is a traction problem. This is a problem that the bees are not able to actually grab hold of this very well.
There's great traction on this twist to close, and so it starts to make sense as far as why the bees like this so much.
I tried to replicate the twist to open results using everything that I could think of that had good traction. This is P80 sandpaper, a screen mesh. This is cork, and then these are Velcro. One side is the loops, and one side's the hooks, with the idea that the bees may really like one of these the best. Some just dumped out into the beehive, which is what happened with the mesh. It was awful. Some didn't do much, like the sandpaper. The ones that really shined were the Velcro. It gave the bees a great traction and didn't leak as much as the others. After having good success with the Velcro, I thought to myself, how do I make it so that it doesn't drip like all of these do, including the commercial versions, and boy do they drip, but yet have the traction that the bees really, really like. I thought to myself, wouldn't it be crazy to use something like sponge? Because then it would actually soak up anything that was coming out of the feeder that was excess, and it would actually act as a membrane where the bees could all feed off of it at the same time, rather than just having one or two holes. The whole thing becomes a feeder, basically. I ended up taking one of the regular lids and just putting sponge on it. And you'll be surprised at the results. This is a video of the sponge feeder, and you can see not only is it not dripping, and it doesn't drip when you turn it over also, which is really nice, but the bees feed from it vigorously. This is sped up about 20 times its normal speed. I may even speed it up a little faster just to get the point across quickly. But you can see how interested that the bees are in it and how much they work it. This one they took 32 ounces from within just a day or two. And if you're curious how this stacks up against other feeders, here's an example where I'm showing the normal commercial feeders as a control versus the Velcro and then also the sponge itself. All of these feeders are in real time, and I think you can see the preference that the bees have. The other thing that surprised me was not only did the bees work on it vigorously, but they worked on it throughout the night. Around 7 p.m. as the sun went down and the foragers would come back from the field, you'd see a lot more bees feeding from all of these feeders. I'll do an entire video on this. It's really fascinating to watch the ebbs and flows. One of the things to note on the video too is when the bees are obscuring the camera, that's because there's so much drippage on the camera that the bees are actually feeding mostly off the bottom. And you see that quite a bit with some of these commercial ones. They end up feeding probably as much, if not more, off of the bottom because of the dripping than they do off of the feeder itself. Here you can actually see multiple bees drowning on the camera lens. It's like a sad form of water torture. And so everybody, I'm really fascinated by this, and I'd like to continue to prototype these. If you'd like to help me out with trying these out as I have supply for it, as I build these out, if you could just reach out to me, I've got a link below. And if you can help me out, I'd really appreciate it. My bees are getting fat from all this feeding. It's kind of getting to be a little excessive. I keep building them up, and it's like, it's a little too much. So if you can help me out with prototyping these, it would really help me out a lot. And as always, I hope you got something out of this video. If you did, like and subscribe.